Good evening, students. So I was discussing artificial hybridization yesterday, and I mentioned the definition of artificial hybridization. So I'll continue with that. So I give the definition of artificial hybridization. So the technique of crossing two different plants belonging to different variety, species, genera, differing from each other in one or more genotypic characters to produce a hybrid offspring is known as artificial hybridization. It is one of the most important technique used in plant breeding for the improvement of the crop plants. I mentioned in artificial hybridization, it is mainly carried out by trained farmer, it is carried out by a plant breeder. So we need two important aspects here. One, for carrying out this artificial pollination, desired type of pollen range. High quality pollen range we need of desired kind, desired plant controlling the specific characters. Then stigma should be protected from unwanted pollination. Stigma should be protected from unwanted pollination means other pollen grains, incompatible pollen grains should not fall on the stigma. Undesired pollen grain should not fall on the stigma. So that is how these two important aspects are very important in case of artificial hybridization. So how we can maintain these two aspects by carrying out certain practices or steps or procedures in artificial hybridization. So two practices or procedure or steps which we carry out, or precautionary measure, whatever you call, precautionary measure or practice or procedure or step which is carried out in artificial hybridization to ensure the availability of desired type of pollen grain and preventing the stigma from unwanted pollen grains. So what we can carry out here? These are the two precautionary measures or the two procedures which we follow in artificial hybridization. So first, emasculation. So this is a flower. When you select a parental plant, yesterday I told two different parental plant are selected. Yesterday I told one plant A and another one plant B. One is disease resistant and another one what you call high yielding variety, right? So when we select a parental plant, so this is the flower of that parental plant. When this flower is bisexual, it is bisexual parent plant and it has stamen containing anther and it has the gynoecium, the receptive surface which receives the pollen grain, that is stigma. So this bisexual parent plant is treated as, is considered as female parent. It should be treated as, or it should be considered as a female parent. How we can consider it as a female parent? So what we do? We remove the anther. So this is anther. Okay. So I'm telling about emasculation. Emasculation is the practice of removing the anther. This is anther. The practice of removing the anther when it is in bud condition. When it is in bud condition, in the bud condition, in a bisexual flower, in a bisexual flower of a plant which is considered to be female parent, is known as emasculation. Remember, the practice of emasculation definition. The practice of removing anther in the bud condition, okay, in the bud condition, in a bisexual flower of a plant which is considered as female parent. So before the complete opening of the flower, when the flower is in the bud condition itself, we remove what you call the anther from a bisexual flower, so that that parental plant is considered to be female parent. So how we can remove this anther with the help of a clean sterilized forceps? With the help of forceps, we are going to remove, we are going to cut this anther from this bisexual flower. So what will remain in that flower? Only the female reproductive structure. So only the female reproductive structure will be there, that is gynoecium. That's why this parental plant is considered to be female parent. So this is what we call a mass variation. Very important is one mark definition. What is bearing? What is its advantage? That can be asked for 2 marks. What is bearing? What is its advantage? Can be asked for 2 marks. Now, so this is the emasculation. So after the removal of anther, so we have removed the anther now. After the removal of anther, we have to cover that emasculated flower. The emasculated flower is covered with a bag of suitable size. Either it is made up of butter paper or it is made up of polythene bag, whatever it is. The emasculated flower, even non-emasculated flower also. Non-emasculated flower means flower will be usually unisexual, female flower. Unisexual female flower, okay, there we need not carry emasculation. That is removal of anther not required. It is already unisexual female flower. Okay, so emasculated flower is covered with a bag of suitable size. Either it is butter paper or polythene bag. So this technique is known as bagging. So bagging is a technique of covering the emasculated flower. You are removing the anther, yeah. The technique of covering the emasculated flower with a bag of a suitable size made up of either butter paper or polythene bag. This technique is known as bagging. 1 mark definition, emasculation bagging. Okay, remember this definition. Why we have to carry out the bagging? So why we need to carry out bagging? This reason is very important. You should remember this. Emasculation has to be carried out very carefully without damaging the female reproductive structure. The female reproductive structure should not be damaged. If the flower size is large, then we use the forceps and we remove the anther from that flower. Suppose if small sized flowers are there, then what you call anthers can be dipped in the hot water or ethyl alcohol for a brief period of time, then we can remove the anther. Okay, so based on the size of the flower, we follow different procedure to remove the anther. Generally with the help of a pair of forceps, we remove the anther. Now why we need to carry out the bagging? The reason is, see, when you have removed the anther from that bisexual flower, if we do not cover with this polythene bag or butter paper, if we do not cover, then what happens? Unwanted pollen grain can land on the stigma. Unwanted pollen grains can come and land on the stigma, resulting in unwanted pollination. So to prevent the stigma from the contamination with unwanted pollen grain, we have to cover with this polythene bag. When you cover with this polythene bag, what happens? Other pollen grains cannot come and land on the stigma. And the pollen grain should be desired pollen grain, as I told earlier. That's why what we do, we cover with this polythene bag. So the reason for bagging is prevent the stigma with unwanted pollination, or to prevent the stigma, to prevent the stigma, contaminated wet unwanted pollen grain. So we carry out bagging to prevent the stigma contaminated with unwanted pollen grain, or to prevent the stigma with unwanted pollination, we need to carry out bagging. Now you have carried out the bagging, you have covered. Now when the stigma is matured, when the stigma is receptive, when the stigma is mature or it is receptive, now what we do, we remove this polythene bag. We will remove the polythene bag. This stigma is receptive, it is ready to receive the pollen grain. We have selected another parental plant. Okay, that can be a male parent. That can be a male parent. So, from the anther of another parent plant, from the anther of another parental plant which we have chosen, from this anther we need to collect pollen grains. Pollen grains are collected in a petri dish. Okay, so now the desired pollen grain from the anther of another selected parental plant, okay, which have been taken in a petri dish, are brought and they are dusted on the stigma of this flower, emasculated flower. This is artificial pollination carried out by a trained farmer or a plant breeder. So the desired pollen grain from the anther of another selected parental plant which is considered to be male parent, okay, so such desired pollen grains are taken in a petri dish with the help of a brush. With the help of a brush, these pollen grains are dusted on the stigma. This is artificial pollination. Desired pollen grains are given. So you have carried out artificial pollination, desired pollen grains have been dusted. Usually the receptivity of the stigma will be more during morning hours after sunrise. Okay, that's why artificial pollination is carried out during morning hours. The pollen grains which have been taken from the anther and collected in the petri dish with the help of a brush, these pollen grains are dusted on the stigma of that emasculated flower. Now once again, what we have to do? We have to do rebagging. This desired pollen grain should not be carried away from the stigma. There is every chance that unwanted pollen grain can come and contaminate the stigma. If you leave open that emasculated flower which has been pollinated now, that's why we need to carry out the rebagging. So once again, the pollinated flower has been covered with the polythene bag or a butter paper of a suitable size. This is rebagging. So now as usual, what happens, pollination has been done, mediated by farmer. Now this pollen grain will germinate, so a desired pollen grain, so compatible pollen grain is there. So pollen pistil interaction occur, this pollen grain germinate after receiving the chemical stimulus from the stigma. Pollen grain will germinate and it will produce pollen tube, will carry the male gamete. So as usual, fertilization occurs. So it takes time. So this rebagged flower should be left for a few weeks. Few weeks you have to leave so that fertilization occur and allow the fruit to develop. So it results after few weeks. What happens? it leads to the fertilization process, and later on allow the fruit formation or fruit development. So this is how we need to carry out emasculation and bagging in artificial hybridization. Remember, so this is the bisexual parental plant which has bisexual flower. Now unisexual flowers, if the parent plant is already unisexual, you have male and female parent. The parental plant has what you call unisexual flowers. The parental plant has unisexual flower, male flower and female flower. The condition can be monoecious condition or dioecious condition, whatever it is. So if already it is unisexual female flower, then we need not carry out any emasculation because stamens are absent in this female flower. So no need to carry out emasculation when the selected parental plant is possessing unisexual female flowers. No need to carry out emasculation. But what you can do if it is unisexual female flower having only gynoecium, pistil, stigma, style, ovary, okay? So what we can do, we can carry out bagging to prevent the contamination of pollen grain, that is contamination of stigma with unwanted pollen grain, to prevent the unwanted pollination of the stigma. So as usual, that unisexual female flower has to be covered with a polythene bag. So we carry out bagging when unisexual female flowers are there in the selected parental plant. In that case, we don't carry out emasculation. So as it is, what you do when the stigma attain receptivity, when it mature, when it is ready to receive the pollen grain, now you remove that polythene bag, then the male flower which is there, okay, from that we need to collect the pollen grain, okay, after the desired pollen grain, compatible pollen grain. So you remove the polythene bag. After removing the polythene bag, now once again what we have to do, the desired pollen grains, okay, should be dusted on the what I call the stigma. Artificial pollination is carried out by that trained farmer. And once again, after carrying out artificial pollination, we need to rebag it. Once again, we have to rebag it. Okay, so this is in case of bisexual parent, and this is in case of unisexual parent. So these are the two what I call procedures, okay, or precautionary measures to be carried out in artificial hybridization to ensure the artificial pollination carried out with the desired pollen grain and preventing the stigma from unwanted pollen grains, preventing the contamination of the stigma with undesired pollen grains. So this is all about what we call artificial hybridization. Remember this, based on this 2 marks maximum question you can expect in theory, and the neat question also can appear. Okay, next concept now. Fertilization, particularly double fertilization, especially seen in flowering plant, that is in angiosperms. Listen, we learned yesterday about entry of the pollen tube into the ovule. Three different route by which the entry of pollen tube carrying the male gamete into the ovule. We learned about porogamy. So this pollen tube carrying what I call the male gametes will enter the ovule. After that, the entry of pollen tube into the embryo sac. Entry of pollen tube into the embryo sac. So what happens here? This the pollen tube enters the embryo sac through the synergid. It passes through the synergid. Synergid has filiform apparatus which attract and guide the pollen tube entry into what I call the embryo sac into the synergid. We learned yesterday. So what happens now after the entry of the pollen tube into the synergid? One of the synergid is invariably destroyed due to the entry of the pollen tube. So this pollen tube, what happens, which carry the male gametes, okay, initially it may have the larger vegetative nucleus or tube nucleus. That tube nucleus will degenerate or disintegrate, and the tip of the pollen tube in its cytoplasmic content will be there, cytoplasm of the pollen grain. Okay, so this tip of the pollen tube will have only now the two male gametes. So now what happens is the tip of the pollen tube can develop pore. It develop pore. Through these pore, the male gametes will be discharged, released into the cytoplasm of the synergid. Cytoplasm of synergid.
X body, darkly stained DNA containing body is present in the synergid, also helps in what you call attracting and guiding the pollen to entry into the synergid or female gametophyte or embryo sac and haploid. So what happens now? This is the egg nucleus and this is synergid nucleus. Now, two male gametes have been released into the cytoplasm of the synergid. So here we have two polar nuclei. So now one of the male gametes which is there, it moved towards the egg. The haploid male gamete. Okay, it moves towards the egg. The male gamete will fuse with female gamete, that is mainly female nucleus. It moves towards the female gamete. This is the egg which you have. Okay, egg. It contains a vacuole towards mitophile and nucleus towards this side, apical side. Okay, so one of the male gamete will move towards the what you call female gamete. The male nucleus will fuse with the female nucleus. It result in the formation of diploid zygote. So the fusion of male nucleus with the female nucleus, this process is known as syngamete. So the process of fusion of male and female gamete, usually we refer it as fertilization. The process of fusion of male gamete with female gamete is known as fertilization. So fertilization involves mainly two events here. The two events are, one is syngamete and another one, triple fusion. So the fusion of male nucleus with the female nucleus to form diploid zygote, this process we call it as syngamy. The syngamy was discovered by a German biologist by name Strasburger. Strasburger has discovered this syngamy, or just normal fertilization, what we call. This angiosperm or flowering plant in fertilization, okay, in fertilization, it involved two events. One is syngamy and another one triple fusion. That's why this fertilization is known as double fertilization, unique to angiosperm, unique to flowering plant. This double fertilization can be asked for 3 mark, very important. Explain the process of double fertilization, very important for 3 mark. You have to explain the syngamy and triple fusion. Okay, so what happened now? One of the male nucleus, it has moved towards the egg and it has fused to form diploid zygote. This is syngamy. One more male gamete is there. So this one more male gamete, which is there, yeah. This is one more male gamete. This one more male gamete will move towards what you call the center of that embryo sac, which we call it a central cell. The central cell has two haploid polar nuclei. It has a two haploid polar nuclei, or what we say, secondary nucleus. Secondary nucleus when we call, when the two haploid polar nuclei have fused just before fertilization to form a diploid structure, that is secondary nucleus or definitive nucleus. So this fertilization, where male gamete will fuse with female gamete to form diploid zygote,
It is not for affordance. Generative fertilization. Remember, it is also referred as generative fertilization. The male gametes are produced mainly by the generative cell of the pollen grain. So it is generative fertilization. It is going to generate what is called diploid zygote. This zygote later on develop into embryo. Embryo, from that we are going to get a small seedling. Okay. So now another male gamete which is there, it moved towards the polar nucleus. So here you have male gamete, which is haploid. Two male gametes will be there. One has fused with the egg nucleus, and another now will fuse with diploid secondary nucleus. Either it is diploid secondary nucleus, when two polar nuclei, the haploid polar nuclei, when they fuse, you will get a diploid secondary nucleus. Suppose if they are not fused, then as usual, what happens? This is one polar nuclei haploid, and this is one polar nuclei haploid. So two polar nuclei will be there. Haploid, two polar nuclei. The male gamete is also haploid. So what will be the resulting product here? So we will get here triploid. We will get a triploid primary endosperm nucleus. Primary endosperm nucleus, which will be triploid in nature. As the three nuclei are involved here, one haploid male gamete and the two haploid polar nuclei. Okay, or it can be a diploid secondary nucleus, whatever it is. Three haploid nuclei are involved here in this fusion. That's why this process we call it as triple fusion. This process is called as triple fusion. So triple fusion, the process in which one of the male gamete will fuse with the diploid secondary nucleus to form triploid primary endosperm nucleus. This is called as triple fusion. And other names also. Triple fusion is also referred as vegetative fertilization. It is also called as vegetative fertilization. Trophomyxis is also known as trophomyxis. Okay, triple fusion or vegetative fertilization, or it is trophomyxis. So the fertilization which involves two events. One is syngamy. Okay, this is syngamy, and another one triple fusion, then we call it as double fertilization. So this double fertilization occur in this female gametophyte or embryo sac, the female gametophyte or embryo sac of a ovule, where this double fertilization occur. It is unique to angiosperms or flowering plant. That remember, double fertilization is not seen in gymnosperm. It is seen only in flowering plant, that is angiosperms. Keep it in mind. So this double fertilization, for the first time it was discovered by S.G. Nemestyin in 1898 in Fritillaria. This double fertilization was discovered for the first time.
did not. In 1899, he also discovered double fertilization in lithium. So what we say, double fertilization was discovered by Navestin and Gignard. They discovered this double fertilization. Normal syngamy, fusion of male and female gamete, that is fertilization, discovered by Strasburger. Remember this. So now we got what I call diploid zygote due to syngamy. This diploid zygote will develop into embryo. Embryo development occur after fertilization. So post-fertilization event, post-fertilization structure, which we learn now shortly. Then the triploid primary endosperm nucleus, it develops into endosperm. So what happens? This is the central cell. After triple fusion, this will become primary endosperm cell. After triple fusion, I'm talking. Okay, this primary endosperm cell develops into endosperm, triploid endosperm. Primary endosperm cell, what it will have? Primary endosperm nucleus will be there, yes. That is because one male gamete has fused with secondary nucleus or two haploid polar nuclei. So this is a triploid primary endosperm nucleus will be there. So primary endosperm cell can develop into a triploid nutritive tissue, that is endosperm, later on. So this is about double fertilization, which involve mainly syngamy and triple fusion, discovered by S.G. Navestin and Gignard in Fritillaria and Lilium respectively. So this is about double fertilization. Remember, syngamy, also called as generative fertilization, and triple fusion is also called as vegetative fertilization, or it is also called as tropomyxis. So these terms you try to remember. Diploid zygote can later on develop into embryo, and this triploid primary endosperm nucleus can develop into endosperm, or triploid primary endosperm cell, which is there now, can develop into endosperm. So this is about the unique event which occur in flowering plant, that is double fertilization. So now we have to learn post fertilization structure and event, means after the fertilization, whatever the structures developed in plant, in flower, or what kind of events occur in the flower, that we have to learn. Post-fertilization structures and events. The structures or the events which occur after fertilization, called as post-fertilization structures or post-fertilization events.
So what we got now, see, post-fertilization structures and even lot of changes occur in the flower. Lot of changes occur in the flower after fertilization. Post-fertilization changes in a flower.
Usually,
sepals can fall down. Usually, sepals, calyx, which is made up of sepals, sepals fall down. In some case, persistent calyx can be present. Persistent calyx, even after formation of the fruit, calyx remain attached to the fruit. So persistent calyx you can find in brinjal, solanum, tomato, chili, etc. Usually after fertilization, sepals wither, sepals falls down. Some cases, sepals, calyx remain attached to the fruit. That is called as persistent calyx. Petals fall down. Stigma and style wither. Stamens falls down or fall down. Now important changes which occur in the flower. Ovary after fertilization develop into fruit. Ovary after fertilization develop into fruit. Ovary wall. Become fruit wall. Ovary wall become fruit wall. Fruit wall is also called as pericarp. The ovules which are there in the locule of the ovary, ovules will become seed. Ovules will become seed. Ovule has integument. Usually one integument, that is unitegmic, two integuments, bitegmic. Integuments will be there, protective covering. Okay. Usually two integuments we see. Okay. So integuments. Outer integument will become testa. Inner integument will become tegma. Okay, so integuments of the ovule will become seed coat. Seed coat, which is a protective covering around the seed. So outer testa, inner tegma, they are seed coat. So integuments will transform into seed coat. Zygote develops into important structure, that is embryo. Primary endosperm nucleus. Primary endosperm nucleus. It develops into endosperm. It develops into endosperm, a nutritive tissue. It usually persists. It usually persists In mature seed, you call it as endospermic seed. Sometime endosperm can be completely consumed by the developing embryo, then you call it as non-endospermic seed, whatever it is. So these are the two most important what you call structures. Okay, one is the embryo and another one endosperm. So how the embryo development occur, how endosperm formation occur, that we have to learn. The mucilage will remain in the what you call ovule, surrounding that embryo sac or female gametophyte. Mucilage will be usually consumed by the developing embryo sac. It is used up, consumed. In some case, mucilage can persist, remain. When persistent mucilage is there, it is called as perisperm. The micropyle of the ovule, remain as micropyle in seed. Remain as micropyle in seed, because seed has micropyle opening through which water can enter, oxygen can diffuse. That is essential for the germination of the embryo to form the seedling. The associated structures, synergid, which is associated with the egg as egg apparatus, that will degenerate, okay, antipodals also will degenerate. So these are all what I call post-fertilization changes that occur, that is seen in a flower. This is a fertilized embryo sac. This is the degenerating synergid. The synergids will degenerate. The egg which is there in the center of the egg apparatus has fused with male gamete, and it has resulted in the formation of important structure, that is the diploid zygote. And in the center here, okay, it has resulted in the formation of what you call a primary endosperm nucleus. Okay, primary endosperm nucleus or primary endosperm cell, which is there in the center. Primary endosperm nucleus or primary endosperm cell, right? And these are what you call degenerating antipodals. Okay, these are degenerating antipodals. So zygote, one very important structure, and another one, this primary endosperm nucleus develop into endosperm. Okay, this zygote develops into embryo. Zygote develops into embryo, and primary endosperm nucleus develops into endosperm. So these are two most important structures associated with the post-fertilization structure and events. Remember, endosperm formation will start before the embryo development. Endosperm formation precedes embryo development. That is essential because the endosperm is a nutritive tissue, provide the nourishment to the developing embryo. So when the zygote start dividing mitotically, it form embryo. Embryo need food, nutrients. That nutrient is supplied mainly by the endosperm. So first we have to learn about endosperm. This endosperm. Endosperm is a product of triple gamete. You know, one of the male gamete will fuse with two haploid polar nuclei or a diploid secondary nucleus to form primary endosperm nucleus. Okay, so one of the male gamete will fuse with diploid secondary nucleus to form triploid structure, that is primary endosperm nucleus. Okay, or the cell, what you call primary endosperm cell, which contain this primary endosperm nucleus, which develops into endosperm. Endosperm development or formation, endosperm development or formation precedes, means before, embryo development. Before the embryo development, so endosperm formation precedes embryo development. So endosperm is a triploid nutritive tissue. What it is? Triploid nutritive tissue. This endosperm in its cells, store abundant reserve food material. Endosperm in its cell or endosperm tissue stores abundant reserve food material, nutrients, different nutrients. So endosperm provide proper nourishment to developing embryo. So endosperm provide proper nourishment to developing embryo. So before the zygote starts dividing rapidly and develop into embryo, before that endosperm formation should be there, so that endosperm, when it is formed, it store the food material and supply the nutrients to the developing embryo. So endosperm is a triploid nutritive tissue, provide proper nourishment to the developing embryo. So endosperm store different kind of what you call nutrient in it. So nature of endosperm is variable based on the type of the food material it has stored. So based on the type of the food material it store, the plant like cereals, wheat, rice, the nature of endosperm, starchy endosperm, it store starch. It is starchy endosperm. So these are rich in starch. Starch is a polysaccharide, carbohydrate. Cereal like maize, proteinaceous endosperm. In maize, you have a yellowish protein storing layer, yellow color protein storing layer, that is aileron layer, it is a protein layer. Okay, present in maize. In case of castor and coconut, it is oily endosperm. It store oil or lipids. Oil or lipids are stored in castor and coconut. Ivory palm, cellulosic endosperm. Ivory palm, cellulosic endosperm. Date palm, hemicellulosic endosperm, hemicellulosic endosperm. So these are all different plant examples and what kind of reserve food material they are storing in this. This you remember. You have stony endosperm, hard, stony endosperm in areca nut, betel nut, adike, beetle, then in date palm, in areca nut and in date palm, stony endosperm will be there. Usually endosperm is triploid, it is triploid. In an example, Onothera, endosperm is diploid, remember. In an example, Onothera, endosperm is diploid. Endosperm in case of gymnosperm is haploid. Endosperm in gymnosperms is haploid. It is a pre-fertilization structure. It is a pre-fertilization structure. In flowering plant, it is post-fertilization structure. Remember, stony endosperm in case of areca nut, that is beetle nut, adike, and in date palm, khajur. And the endosperm is diploid in case of example, Onothera. Remember, right? So, we'll continue tomorrow.